So, we continue our conversation here with a discussion of methods of intelligence, methods of investigation, our methods of investigation, that is. We have folks who have revealed police collusion in state killings. We have folks who have figured out how to both reveal and protect health data. We have a person who will give you basically a how-to to do some of this intelligence gathering. And then we have some guy who leaked the Pentagon Papers. I want to welcome Daniel Ellsberg to our panel. I think we let Daniel Ellsberg bite into lunchtime, right? All right, so let's start with Northern Ireland, the place that I started reporting in the early 80s and was actually honored to meet one of our panelists. Paul O'Connor is now director of the Pat Finucane Center. The center has offices in Derry, Armagh, and Dublin. It's named after a lawyer who was assassinated by loyalist paramilitaries in 89. He and his co-speaker, presenter here today, Anne Cadwallader, Cadwallader.
Well done.
Close. Who is the author of this book? She'll forgive me if I promote her book. Lethal Allies, which is for sale at a special conference price of just £12 right outside, have spent years now researching police collusion in state killings in Northern Ireland, and they're going to talk to us about exactly how they compiled this dossier and how you can do something similar too, not to mention the impacts that it will have. I'm going to introduce all of the panelists so that you can come up one after the other, I think is probably the best way to save time. Karin Spaink writes about health politics and technology. She was sued by Scientology for almost 10 years over publishing excerpts of their higher level courses. She won, you'll be happy to hear. She co-founded the Dutch digital rights organization Bits of Freedom, which she chaired for 7 years, and was the chair of the Dutch Big Brother Awards for 10 years. Feminism would require that we develop a Big Sister Award also, but maybe we'll do that on another day. Also with us is Nicky Hager. He's an author and investigative journalist, whom I'm sure most of you know. His books include Secret Power and Other People's Wars. He lives in New Zealand, and he's come all this way to tell us how to do what he does. But let's start with Anne, I think, right? Lethal Allies. Thank you. I'm going to be sitting right there, and I'll nudge you into time. Thanks.
Great. Well, thank you very much for inviting me. My name, as you heard, is Anne Cadwallader. I've worked in Northern Ireland for 34 years, mostly as a journalist, and then more recently as a caseworker with the Pat Finucane Centre. Now, the centre, as Laura also said, is named after the Belfast solicitor, Pat Finucane, who was shot dead in front of his wife and children in 1989. After three investigations by the former chief constable of the Metropolitan Police, Sir John Stevens, the British government finally admitted he was shot dead by loyalists in collusion with both the police, the RUC, and with British military intelligence. London is still, we say, disgracefully holding out on its firm promise of a public inquiry into his murder. The Pat Finucane Centre works with bereaved families to try and find out who killed their loved ones. We believe London's failure to uphold the rule of law was the single most significant cause of the conflict in Northern Ireland. London has, however, always been very assiduous in covering its tracks in Ireland. The historian, Professor James Bowyer Bell, said nothing has been spared, resources, intimidation, loyalty, greed and patriotism in this endeavour. In the last resort, he says, London simply denies the evidence. Collusion is a word that has been unfortunately debased over time by some for political purposes. There is no crime on the British statute book called collusion, and no agreed definition of what it is. We in the PFC believe that if police officers or soldiers conspire to murder people or ignore what they know about murder, or if they cover up what they know, that's collusion. But collusion is difficult to prove, as the only witnesses to the original act are the guilty parties. The murderous acts carried out by colluders leave plenty of evidence, but the original conspiracy rarely does, unless someone breaks cover, and there are powerful reasons why this is so rare. Collusion, however, is absolutely vital to understanding the conflict in Ireland. Most of you in this room will believe it was based on religious differences, with London benevolently trying to keep the peace. that Catholics and Protestants were fighting each other, that loyalist and Republican paramilitaries were mirror images of each other. Well, given what we have uncovered, we see it somewhat differently. That London was a key player and used the kind of counterinsurgency tactics it had already honed in previous colonial wars in Malaya, Kenya, the Middle East, and elsewhere. The result of over 10 years' research into one series of time and geographically limited series of events is contained in the PFC's book published last year called Lethal Allies, British Collusion in Ireland. I'm glad to say it's become a bestseller in Ireland, and I have some copies here with me. The book names 25 loyalists, most of them murderers, who were also serving or former members of the Royal Ulster Constabulary or the British Army in Ireland. Sadly, we have been unable to name most of their masters in London who pulled their strings. Just as a quick introduction, this is a very short account of the various forces acting on the state side during the conflict in Ireland. There was the UDR, the largest regiment in the British Army, whose members were locally recruited, armed and trained to kill. Then there was the UVF, the Ulster Volunteer Force, an illegal group of killers, some of whom were also members of the legal UDR. The UDA was the largest but least disciplined of the loyalist forces. It wasn't banned until 1992, although it carried out hundreds of sectarian assassinations, its victims almost invariably Catholic non-combatants, shot dead while going about their ordinary day's business at work, at play, or at home in their beds. The RUC was the Royal Ulster Constabulary, 90% Protestant, and then, of course, there are all the other shadowy forces inflicted on the people of Northern Ireland, MI5, MI6, and so on, none accountable for their actions. Coming now to the key point, how did we carry out our research and make the shocking discoveries we did? We looked in all the usual places and some very unusual ones. The National Archives here in London, whenever we could afford to visit. We talked to bereaved families and eyewitnesses. We worked alongside any inquiry set up, whenever that happened, not often. And then we worked with the Historical Inquiries Team, a group of mainly former British police officers set up in Northern Ireland by a former Chief Constable of the Police Service in Northern Ireland, and more about that later. Finally, we also spoke to whistleblowers, but others here will go into that in more detail. So what did we find in the National Archives? The answer is a lot, but I'm limited on time, so here are just a few examples. Firstly, we found this document, which shows that even as they were setting up the UDR, the British government knew it would be used by loyalist paramilitaries to train and arm themselves against the nationalist population. I could give you dozens of examples of how that worked out in practice, but here's just one. The carnage caused on the single most devastating day of the conflict, the Dublin and Monaghan bombings in which 34 people, including an unborn child, perished in May 1974. These bombs were planned by a group of UDR men in conjunction with the UVF. We can name three with total confidence, but we strongly suspect others. This most significant extract from official papers shows that as early as 1976, barely 4 years into a 30-year conflict, the British Prime Minister of the day, Harold Wilson, and the then leader of the opposition, Margaret Thatcher, were being briefed that the largest regiment in the British Army, the UDR, was, quote, heavily infiltrated by extremist Protestants, i.e. loyalist paramilitaries, and that in a crisis could not be relied upon to be loyal. Indeed, the UDR became the main source of weapons for loyalist paramilitaries and the only source of modern weapons, such as Stirling submachine guns. Stirling submachine guns, such as the one used to kill these 11 people, including the father of my colleague at the PFC, Alan Brecknell. It orphaned 5 children and left 19 fatherless. There was not even an investigation into its disappearance. Our second source was the families to whom we spoke, many of whom had never been asked before to say what they'd seen at the time of the attacks. They confirmed the paucity of the original police investigations, and on several occasions were able to give us key corroborating information about perpetrators. Our third source was, believe it or not, old newspapers. When you have no access to confidential police information, you have to take what you can find. In the triangulation process, where you're trying to corroborate information from elsewhere, old court reports can help identify who was picked up and questioned, who was charged, who was acquitted or convicted, and that can be vital. Our fourth source was the Barron inquiry in Dublin into the Dublin Monaghan bombings. As an official government inquiry in the south, it had limited access to RUC data in the north, and we gained massively important ballistic evidence linking the bombs in Dublin and Monaghan to a string of other murders north of the border. Mr. Justice Barron concluded it was neither fanciful nor absurd to believe that members of the RUC and British Army were involved in mass murder, and that it was also likely that individual members of both organisations either took part or planned mass murder. Mind you, London is still withholding massive amounts of intelligence and other documentation, which it refused to provide to the Barron inquiry, so there may be more to come if we ever get to see the papers. This is the kind of diagram that my colleague Alan Brecknell managed to draw up after the Barron inquiry. It links perpetrators and weapons through the series of murders we were investigating and established they were indeed all carried out by permutations of the same gang. Then we come to the HET again. Its senior officers had supposedly unfettered access to RUC archives. The PFC took a decision to engage with the HET, although other human rights groups decided not to become involved. The HET was a deeply flawed truth recovery mechanism, but so far it has been the only one. One of the most incriminating cases the HET investigated was the bombing of the Step Inn in the village of Cady. They found evidence that RUC Special Branch knew of the bomb, had the gang under surveillance, but allowed the attack to go ahead, killing two people and injuring a further 30. Then there's the case of the four families whose loved ones were killed in a double-barred gun and bomb attack in 75. They believe for three decades the main man responsible was a cheese processor. The HET revealed that he was in fact a serving police officer. After 5 years of work combing through the archives, the HET, which remember consisted of former police officers, mainly from England, concluded these events should have sent alarm bells ringing all the way to the top of government, yet nothing was done and the murderous cycle continued. Furthermore, the HET said in a separate report, this cannot be blamed on a few rotten apples, as the British government and unionists often claim. No, they said their investigations had the potential to validate claims of widespread and routine collusion. So we come to whistleblowers. This will be a whistle-stop tour of that, as others are dealing with this topic. We had evidence from three with varying standards of credibility. We had evidence from one, Colin Wallace, a former British Army press officer, about this man, Robin Jackson, possibly the most prolific killer during the entire conflict, who was also an RUC agent. If you look at our website, you'll find more about him. This slide shows you Colin Wallace's own handwriting dating back to 74. He's talking about Robin Jackson's involvement in the murder of a Catholic trade unionist and father of three, Pat Campbell, the previous year. Charges, wrote Wallace, against Jackson were dropped following RUC's special branch intervention. Thank you for listening, and I'll take questions later.
My job this morning, I think, is to give you a taster of some of the other work that we're involved in. I think Anne has outlined very well the work that we've done around the issue of collusion between loyalist paramilitaries and the security forces. And I just want to give you a taster of some of the other documentation that we found in the National Archives in Kew. And we have over 10,000, 12,000 declassified documents in our offices. So what we're doing today is really just giving you the briefest tour through that, of some of these documents and some of the issues that arise through that. However, returning briefly to the issue of Pat Finucane, sometimes even private secretive reviews reveal damning new evidence. And we had it the De Silva review into the murder of Pat Finucane. This review was ordered by David Cameron when he met Pat Finucane's family 2 years ago. That review, although extremely limited, revealed that between 87 and December 89, there was 270 separate incidents of security force leaks to loyalist paramilitaries. According to MI5 itself, 85% of the intelligence material in the hands of the largest loyalist group, the UDA, came from security force sources. And according to the same report, it was the police, the RUC, who suggested Pat Finucane as a murder target for loyalist paramilitaries. This is a diagram from his report, from his December 2012 report, where we see the source of some of these leaks. 8% from the army, 27% from the homegrown regiment of the British Army, the UDR, which was the largest regiment in the British Army, 4% from Special Branch, 19% from the police, and 41% unknown. So when we hear the Retired Police Officers Association tell us that there is no actual evidence of collusion, these are the official reports, the official documents. So I want to just take you on a very brief tour through some of the other kind of documentation we find. And for instance, this is a record of a meeting between the British government, Sir Frank Cooper, and other senior officials in Belfast, and loyalist paramilitary. So you'll see that at the meeting were the UVF, who 6 months prior to this meeting had bombed Dublin and Monaghan and killed 33 people, the Orange Volunteers, another loyalist paramilitary group, the UDA, and one other UVF man, not known. And at the meeting, they complained that the police were not recruiting enough people, that there was discrimination against loyalists, and that there was discrimination against former detainees. In other words, they were, the loyalist paramilitary groups were meeting the government to urge them to recruit more loyalist ex-prisoners. How bizarre is that? Another document that we find at the time, and by the way, we've dozens of these documents to back this up, it's not one document, is that the Ministry of Defence at the time must have been the only Ministry of Defence in Western Europe or in NATO to have a series of documents called Arrest Policy for Protestants. Now what this in effect was a policy on when not to arrest loyalists. They list a whole series of categories where loyalists are not to be arrested, which is, as you would agree, a fairly bizarre type of policy for the Ministry of Defence to have. At the same time, we found these lists of statistics. This one, for example, is from 1976. Now, I'll give you a short guide through this here. At the very top in blue, you see a particular period of who has been killed and wounded by, and they characterise it by Protestant extremists or by Catholic extremists. That's their definition of it. Now, you'll notice that in that particular week, the IRA and other Republican groups hadn't killed or wounded anyone. And in the same week, loyalist paramilitaries had killed 4 and injured 16. Now go down to the screening statistics. Screening was a process whereby people would get arrested at random by the British Army, taken to an army post, and you would be screened. You would be asked, how many rooms in your house? Do you have a dog? How many are in your family? Who's working? What are your political views? And they would build up an intelligence picture of entire communities. It was later ruled to be illegal. Now we look at the screening statistics and it's broken down to 3rd Battalion, 8th Battalion and 39th Battalion. In other words, all 6 counties of Northern Ireland. And they've actually quite helpfully broken it down by religion. And we see that in that 6 month period, 1,946 people were screened. Now look at the very bottom table and you'll see that 3rd Battalion in that 1 week screened 3 Catholics and no Protestants. 8th Battalion, 16 Catholics and no Protestants. 39th Battalion were very active, 29 Catholics and no Protestants. And we see their attitude towards a group that was actually heavily involved in violence during that precise period. Moving on now to a separate issue, and that is the issue of prosecution or non-prosecution of soldiers who were killing civilians. And we find, for instance, that General Sir Cecil Blacker is writing to Lieutenant General Frank King. He says, the Attorney General has assured me that he himself carefully reviews every serious allegation against a soldier. He assured me in plainest terms that not only he himself, but also the Director of Public Prosecutions and senior members of his staff, having been army officers themselves, having seen active service, were by no means unsympathetic in their approach to soldier prosecutions in Northern Ireland. We see here that they've agreed there will never be a conflict between the Attorney General and the general officer commanding the British Army in Northern Ireland, and ministerial intervention will be unlikely. This was entirely illegal to give the army this level of access on prosecutions. So we have ministers and civil servants in Whitehall making decisions, and we've bereaved and anguished families at home, and you'll see why we flagged this up. This is one case where we found the papers in the case, and it involved the killing of a man called J.P. Cunningham, who was seen, and you'll see in the army log down below, believed to have a mental age of 10 years of age. He was a vulnerable adult. In the regimental log, they referred to him as the village idiot. You see here that he was terrified of soldiers. He was confronted in a country road. He turned, he ran into a field, and he was shot and killed. The soldiers who killed him were never questioned by the police, and the family was offered £750. Move on to another case. This involved a child that was killed, and the family of the child, a 12-year-old, were seeking £1,000 compensation. And in this case, a civil servant here in Whitehall ruled that the accepted rate for a minor is £750. In this case, involving a man called Christopher Quinn, it's quite an interesting case because the legal advice in this case was that Christopher Quinn was entirely innocent, that he was unarmed, that he left behind five children, and therefore the case was valued at £10,000. But the counsel for the Ministry of Defence said that the family was willing to accept £750 because they were going to be forced to go into court and the onus should be put on the plaintiff, as they said. In effect, he got £500. So these are the type of documents that we find in the archives. During the conflict, over 350 people were killed by the British Army, some 300 plus by the Army and 50 plus by the RUC, while on duty. As Anne has pointed out, there were many, many instances where people were killed by police officers or soldiers who weren't officially acting in that capacity, but were acting as loyalist paramilitaries. No member of the police was ever convicted of murder. Four soldiers were convicted, but all were released within 5 years of their life sentence, and all four were allowed to rejoin their regiments. Come now to the issue of rubber and plastic bullets. Three people were killed by plastic bullets or by rubber bullets in the early 1970s, and 14 were killed by the subsequent plastic bullets that were introduced. Eight of the victims were under 16 years of age. We find documents from a medical committee whose job it was, whose legal responsibility it was, to advise government ministers on the safety of plastic bullets. They're based at Portendown Chemical Weapons Establishment. And it is their statutory duty to do this. And they are telling us in the correspondence that they are unable to provide such safety advice because the Ministry of Defence is not telling them what are the extent of deaths and injuries on the streets of Belfast and Derry. We also see in the correspondence that all plastic bullet guns that were in use in Northern Ireland were faulty, according to the Safety Committee of Portendown. And, you know, we're not talking a small number here. In 1981-82, there was 30,000 fired that year during the hunger strike. So the plastic bullet guns are faulty, but they're not replaced for a further 5 years. For instance, in 1982, Stephen McConomy was killed. They claimed at the time, at the inquest, that particular gun was faulty. In fact, they knew that all their guns were faulty. Now, I don't want to divert attention from the fact that a soldier shot him at point-blank range, and it's the soldiers responsible. That case is reopened, by the way. One of the documents that we found in the archives was a letter from the Chief Constable of the RUC following a query from the Prime Minister here in London about the amount of people that were coming out of the dedicated interrogation centres with very serious injuries. And he wrote this memo, the Chief Constable of the Police, which is worthy of Monty Python, and it's about the self-inflicted injuries. You see, these clever IRA people, they inflict these injuries on themselves. Some of the injuries that he talks about are feigning illness and attempting to fall off a chair during interview, scratching your wrist with a pin, throwing oneself on a floor, thereby causing injury to the face. Can you imagine how difficult it is to throw yourself on the floor and not use your hands to stop the fall? I mean, those Irish are so devious. Throwing oneself down a flight of stairs, cutting a wrist with a plastic knife, injury to neck by self-strangulation. I don't know what the police are doing while this is happening. Banging your head and wrists on a table, causing a nosebleed, punching one's own face, poking one's own eyes, and so on. Self-burning with cigarettes, burning your limbs on hot radiators, scratching with nails and poking nails into ears. This is the Chief of Police, the Chief Constable. This is his answer back to the Prime Minister on the self-inflicted injuries, I ask you. So, moving swiftly along. The very final issue we come to is that of the hooded men, which the hooded men concerns the case of a number of men who were subjected to in-depth interrogation following the introduction of internment. And this involved five particular methods of interrogation, including hooding, wall standing, white noise, and so on. The men, when they were finally released from internment, sought damages from the government and took legal action. And this is the legal advice that came back. Her Majesty's government sought the very best legal advice on the civil actions, which claimed wrongful arrest, trespass, conspiracy, and so on. The gravest allegation is that of conspiracy between the defendants, i.e. the Northern Irish Prime Minister Brian Faulkner and Lord Charrington, Minister of Defence, to subject the plaintiff to lawful acts. We are advised that the only practical case was to settle these actions out of court. Why? Because they knew that they would otherwise face very serious charges. The Irish government, as a result, took this case to the European Court of Human Rights. It was the first interstate case to go to the court, and it was the only case to run its full length through the European Court of Human Rights. In 1978, the European Court of Human Rights ruled that the treatment of the men was inhumane, degrading, but not torture, because there was no evidence of command responsibility. There was no evidence of ministerial involvement. There was no evidence that it was a policy. So in the archives, we began to find documents. We went to Irish state television earlier this year and finished this. We went to Irish state television. They looked for further documents and came across the following memo from the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland in the mid-1970s, Merlin Rees, where he said, "It is my view that the decision to use methods of torture," he's quite clear that it is torture, "was taken by ministers, in particular Lord Charrington, then Secretary of State for Defence." He's quite clear about that. So after the programme, we and others approached the Irish government, and last week they approached the European Court and asked for the case to be reopened. Now the case is highly significant because this judgment in the European Court that this was not torture but was ill treatment has been used by the Israeli Supreme Court to justify the treatment of Palestinians. And it was used extensively in the torture memo that was supplied to President Bush in the run-up to the Iraq War. And there's every hope now that that judgment can be overturned. Thank you.
Kia ora tātou. I'm going to give a short, practical talk about the protection of sources, and particularly the protection of sources in an era of mass surveillance systems. And one of the reasons I want to do this is that I've heard pessimistic talk about how sources can't realistically be protected in an age of electronic surveillance and so on. I don't believe this is correct, and I think that there's so much work to be done, we shouldn't be putting ourselves off with ideas like that. I should also begin by saying that there's a bit of ambiguity about what a whistleblower means and what we're protecting, and it's good to distinguish about what we're talking about. I take a whistleblower normally to mean somebody who sticks their head up, identifies themselves, and talks about something they learned when they're inside a job. In my case, out of many dozens of secret and internal sources, I've never had a whistleblower like that, and when people have come to me and suggested they'd like to do it, I have put them off it because I don't believe there are enough protections, and in most cases, apart from some dramatic exceptions, I think you're condemning someone to a life of trouble, and that's except for the dramatic exceptions, of course. So what we've got is we've got whistleblowers, but there's also a category which I would call a leaker, who is somebody who is going to serve a huge public service and provide information, but never be known about, do their good works, and continue with their career if they want to. And that's the kind that I'm particularly talking about now. And how we protect their identity, use the information, get the public benefit without the personal harm. A couple of months ago, I had six detectives arrive at my house in friendly New Zealand. And they spent 10.5 hours going through my house, all the parts of my house, opening all the books, going through our drawers, digging through my files, removing all the computers and hard drives and CDs and memory sticks and whatever else they could find, which is an unpleasant experience. But the point of raising it here is that they were looking for my sources, and I don't think there's the slightest chance that they will find who my sources were. That's what the point of this talk is about. They were looking for the sources for a book I'd recently finished and published, which was revealing a dirty tricks campaign inside the Prime Minister's Department in our country, where there had been staff who were deniable but who were being used to smear their opponents. They used intelligence information, which the government had access to try to undermine your opponents. You had someone from the Prime Minister's office breaking inside the opposition Labour Party's computers and digging dirt on them. Very important public issues were going on there. Another interesting aspect of the book from the point of view of this conference is that the information I got for that story, which is a story I'd been pursuing because people around New Zealand, and particularly political people, knew there was something particularly heavy as politics coming out of the government. My source for this was in the Ethical Hacker. And this is a good story because I find in my personal experience that there are a great many hackers who do interesting but not very politically worthwhile work and then go off to work for banks and multinationals. And it's quite a rare and wonderful thing when there's important information that serves the public interest. And this is one of those cases. And as I say, the point of the story is that as certain as I can be, even though we have mass surveillance systems, even though the government was very interested in me at the time and was watching me because of working on the Snowden documents, I think that my source will remain completely safe. Now, how do we do this? The first thing that the police did when they arrived at my house, in fact, the first thing that the police always do when they start an investigation nowadays, is they look for my mobile phone. If you've got something you need to keep secret, a mobile phone is a personal surveillance system. It says who you've been contacting and where you were. It's got timestamps on all your activities, your texts and everything else. And the police nowadays use them for most investigations and convictions. They were deeply crestfallen when they discovered I was one of the few weirdos left who just doesn't have a mobile phone. But it's a warning to everybody else. What we're talking about is call data or metadata, which is the records of who you talked to, what the nearest cell phone tower was, what the duration was, what the time was, and so on. Which is a fantastic investigative tool. If we could have it for our work, we'd love it. The police love having it too. The police don't bug many phones these days. It's too labour-intensive, but they go back and back to that call data when they're investigating leaks, car thieves, or anything else. And so there's a simple answer to this, and that is that if we want to protect the source right from the beginning, we can't leave any electronic tracks at all. You just don't do it. You just never text them. You never email them. You never phone them from a mobile phone. If you have to phone them, wait till you're visiting your obscure aunt and do it from there. But if we don't leave the tracks, it means when we get to publication day, we will hopefully not have to sweat about it. The next thing that the police went for in the house, unsurprisingly, was the computers in the house. And they grabbed them all. And at the moment, they're sealed in the Auckland High Court with a legal battle going on about whether they're allowed to get hold of them. But once again, I am sleeping easy about it. And the main reason I could sleep easy because there's nothing on the computers. And when the book was coming out, I secure wiped them multiple times. But anyway, I've got encryption on my hard drive. And encryption on the hard drive to some people might still sound like a difficult thing, but it's actually compulsory and simple in the modern age. But if you haven't done it before, probably the best way you could lose your data is not by the police coming, but by scrambling your own data. And so, one idea I'd like to bring here is that one of the important parts of my work for more than the last 10 years is that I have entered into a series of incredibly productive relationships with people whose full-time jobs is in IT, in particular in information security. Hackers. People who are some kind of hackers. And I think that for me, this has enhanced my work immensely. It's helped me at the information security level, which is to do with my own encryption and encrypting my hard drive, but also helps me to study certain stories, to dig into data I've been given, to work out the formats of interesting information I've been given, but which I can't access. And the idea I'd like to suggest here is, as part of the idea of this particular conference of investigative journalists and hacktivists, is I think there should be an ongoing one-to-one collaboration set up for all sorts of people who are doing investigative journalism, that it would deeply enhance our work to be working with people who've got hacker skills. Now, one of the characteristics of IT people, it's a very nice synergy, because IT people are often kind of anti-authoritarian. You'll know this from all kinds of organizations. They've got skills. They develop this because of their skills they've got, which most ordinary people don't have. And they're often quite politically motivated. They know about the world and they think about the world. And then they get on with their IT stuff without necessarily very useful outlets or productive outlets in terms of the politics of the world. And so I'd like to suggest that there's a project that we all consider and actually try to build up that we have mechanisms for recommending trustworthy IT people to trustworthy investigative journalists and other reporters to make them into teams who work together on worthwhile projects. As I say, I do this, it has enhanced my work immensely for many years now to have that person there who is collaborating with me and bringing extra tools and extra insights into what I do. However, having said this, even in the age of mass surveillance, the most important tools for protecting sources are the pre-digital ones. The first and most important is that most people can't keep a secret. There's a science to keeping secrets. And if we want to have sources, then we need to understand the dynamics of secrets. And I'm going to tell you a very obvious answer to this. Don't tell anybody. and this might sound obvious, but journalists like lawyers and other so-called careful professions are the biggest blabbermouths around. And the physics of secrets is that if you tell one more person, just one person, and then they tell it to somebody who feels even less responsibility to the secret, then your secrets accelerate away from you. And if you're working on things which are juicy and exciting, actually everyone wants to know about the story. And so the simple answer is, when I meet a source the first time, I say to them, we are going to put a ring fence around the two of us, and no one else will ever know about this till the day I die. And that way, again, I can sleep easily. And this is very important, that actually that is how you keep a secret. It doesn't make a great party story, but it's how you keep a secret. The next thing is that right from the beginning, it's too late when you come up to publish to realise the mistakes you made at the beginning. Right from the beginning, you have to contact people and meet people and continue to meet people in ways which leave no other kind of tracks in the world. For example, don't ask your friend to introduce you if you don't want to have your friend part of that circle later when it becomes interesting and controversial. In other words, care right from the beginning is important. And it's already been mentioned once before, but the other area which I've perhaps spent half of my effort on when I'm writing, when I've finally finished the investigating, is about what information you write down. Because to the reader, they're just hearing an interesting story, but to the investor, to the security officer of the agency you've written about or the company you've written about, every piece of information that you write is points on a grid to try to zero in and triangulate in on your sources. He seems to not know anything before this date. He seems to know nothing after that date. He knows what's happened in this section, but not that interesting thing that happened across the hall. In other words, when I'm writing, I'm constantly thinking, how can I take the information I have and make it as if I'm looking from a different direction, and the shadows are going in different ways, and different things are being emphasised. And sometimes I leave out huge swathes of interesting information, because otherwise I won't protect my sources. And sometimes, if I've got such a brilliant one-source thing for a piece of information, I'll put tremendous effort into finding more information from a different source, I call it diversionary detail, which I can mix together with that to help protect the source, because otherwise it's not usable. And again, if we do that properly, we leave the people who come after us trying to investigate with their heads spinning and just bemused about how we managed to get the information. Final point, I'm just going rattling through quickly here. Final point, I wonder whether this recent history of stunning leaks like Chelsea Manning and Edward Snowden have created an idea that the way that we get fantastic leaks of information to inform the public and to bring to life issues and to bring about change on wrongdoing is that we wait for some incredibly brave whistleblower to step forward. We might have to set up an anonymous secure mailbox or something, and then we wait. But that's not what investigative journalism is about. Most information which comes to me spontaneously is kind of interesting, but it's not what I need to be working on. And investigative journalism is about our own focused, strategic work of seeing questions that need to be answered and lies that need to be undone and issues which need to be brought to life. And the way you work on those is not waiting for a whistleblower. It is by actively going out and searching for people and strategizing and thinking, how many places can this information be in? Within that organization, there's not just the PR person, there's the former staff and the junior staff and the allied organisations, and drawing a map of all the places and then waiting for that interesting magic that happens when you're searching strategically, which is that you get lucky and something comes along because you've been searching for it. And so the point I'm trying to make is that we don't, while you know, thank God for Edward Snowden and so on, and for Chelsea Manning. But the main work we do is where we go searching ourselves, and we don't want to think that with the job of investigative journalism is waiting for the next big hit. And to finish, what I would say is that, in summary, as long as we do that job, and as long as we're persistent, and as long as we understand the risks, even in the age of mass surveillance, and we take sufficient care, I believe that there will continue to be good sources, and that the well of these good sources is not going to dry up. Thank you.
I've been writing about health since the late 80s and about technology and computers since the mid 80s. So when people started talking about electronic patient records, the two interests that I had sort of merged. So I was sort of, oh, that's going to be interesting. And very much to my surprise, I noticed that there was hardly any discussion about the premises, how it would be organized, how it would be protected, how it would be used. The only thing I read, both in medical records and in technology magazines, was basically press releases. We signed a new contract between hospital so-and-so and Volmark, IBM, whatever. It's going to be even bigger, it's going to be even more wonderful, we can do so-and-so, and it was just basically PR that I saw. So once we actually were going to get started with an electronic patient record system in the Netherlands, and actually a national one, I thought it was time to really start examining the issue, and I was rather dumbfounded to see what I found. The notion is that you would make medical information accessible nationwide. So instead of you going to a GP who sends you off to a hospital who then needs to ask the GP via letter what actually was the matter, the people in the hospital would have your information at their fingertips. So that all health information professionals would have the same information, and they can get it without any delay, without paperwork, without needing to make phone calls or what have you. That would force hospitals and GPs, dentists, pharmacies and what have you to cooperate, to share, and of course it would greatly help reduce costs, increase efficiency, while the whole, you know, the sort of charm. And most of all, it would reduce medical errors. Medical errors at that point were sort of being, there was some kind of research, most of it was taken from the US, and then it was sort of explained in Dutch terms. And the funny thing about the numbers that were given, it was sort of 1,800 cases of medical errors due to lack of information and cooperation between professionals, was sort of estimated at 1,800 per year. But slowly, in reports, the numbers started increasing, still based on the same research. So everybody actually inflated the number to quite some degree. But those people would be safe in the future. This is sort of the old situation. You have a pharmacy that gets you the information from the hospital, the specialist gives it to the GP, and everything went at a snail's pace. Very complicated and very inefficient. And this was the new wonderful situation. We would have a national exchange point that would track which data was kept where, and then as a GP, you would sort of ask the hospital via the switchboard for the information. It would stay there, and so only the hospital could change it, but the GP could see it, the dentist could see it in case that was necessary, and the pharmacy could. So the data would be stored where it was created, and you could access it in real time using the internet. Wonderful. One problem that arose is, of course, that patients need to be unique. And in the early 90s, when we started this whole system, the Secretary of Health, Ellsberg, said, we will not use social security numbers for obvious reasons, as in making it too easy to collide different sets of data and, well, to make people too traceable and for privacy reasons. And what happened in 2006, of course, we used our social security number, which was then sort of split up, the number still being the same, it was split up in a social security number for work, taxes and welfare, an education number, and a health number. All the same number, just used in different areas. And, of course, all the unwanted, unforeseen, unaccounted for linking of personal data in many various domains, was becoming a problem. Also, more and more, at the time, nobody thought about it, but identity theft is becoming a big problem as well, when all your data is, all your possibilities and your sort of, your existence in various disciplines is dependent upon a number, the number becomes more valuable, especially for people who don't have access to all these areas. So identity theft is becoming a bigger problem. And another big problem was extending the law with regards to data linking. From the start, this new civil number was meant to assist law enforcement and investigation, which is especially weird when it concerns medical issues, because medical issues have always been very much protected from being used by investigators, as in doctors actually, they can't say that guy probably did some kind of crime and here's his data. They have quite some secrecy laws in place, which to some degree are suddenly lifted by this new social security number. And there had been technical problems, or technical, just errors. In March 2005, there was this hospital in the north of the Netherlands, east of the Netherlands, Spaarne, and they had done quite some digitalization of their patient records, and suddenly in their outpatient clinics, one computer started having problems, and that accelerated, and more computers started having problems. And they cleaned the first computer, but then more computers got the problem, to the point that all data was becoming so slow to access, they had to shut down outpatient visits. They had to shut down the outpatient clinics for a week in order to clean all the records and the computers. It took them quite some time. And they were brave, because they announced it in the press. There have been more of such similar incidents, and people never comment upon it, and they don't give out a press release about it. For instance, there are various radiology departments which have been having bugs, and which found that the previous information on patient records were not available to them because of the virus, or sometimes were damaged, or sometimes were inaccessible. We've had a bug that's... there was a press release about it, but the press release was very, very... it was very little release in it. It was just the press saying there was a problem and you could not figure out what happened. But as it turned out, there was a bug in a program that calculated dosages for chemotherapy in a particular kind of software program. People were getting chemotherapy dosages 10 times too high. And rumor has it that indeed one person has died of this. And more, there were data entry errors. One of the complicated things is you get these drop-down menus where you select the code for the disease or the code for the medication that you're going to get, and the drop-down menu where you say it's 10 milligram or it's 20 milligram. And invariably, people take the wrong selection. They have one too high or one too low, and that's going to be in your record. There is another error where people simply are not used. They're not used to work with these programs. It might sort of become better in the future, but people enter data in two different places, thinking, yeah, but it should be there as well, and not knowing that the program will do it for them. Thereby, they up the doses twice. At the moment, electronic medication programs are currently the fourth cause of new medical errors. Well, actually, they were intended to solve these problems, so there you go. And there was this other problem, a sort of management problem. The Department of Health would allot no extra money for new software or the implementation of electronic patient records. The National Health Inspections would not give a requirement set for this is how you're going to protect your data, this is how you're going to do it, this is the kind of software that you must use. The market will solve it. NICTIS, the guys making this sort of hub in the middle, the switch point, they said, yeah, but the responsibility for the data and the software that people use to connect to us, well, that's their problem, not ours. GPs very often have no knowledge and no infrastructure to sort of set up their own software and their computers, and especially hospitals have lots and lots and lots of legacy software, which makes it very difficult to implement new software that is sort of safe, secure, and bug-free. And of course, the healthcare sector is not very computer savvy. And actually, they're not much bent on privacy, they're bent on sharing information. That's sort of the deal that they're in. So I thought, yeah, well, this whole list of objections, and nobody's going to listen. So what I did, I knew quite a number of people in the healthcare system, and I knew quite a number of hackers, so I thought, ha. I negotiated with three hospitals, of which two agreed. One was a regional hospital, also providing electronic patient record services for GPs, for a nursing home, a revalidation clinic, and they serviced lots and lots of people. Their records were huge. And the other one was one of the biggest academic hospitals in the Netherlands. And I signed contracts with them. I would do a test, how secure their data was, a penetration test, basically. And the results were rather shattering. The academic hospital, actually, it was difficult to get in. We got into one of the remote servers that they found out immediately. The next morning I got this phone call. I found this hacker and he said to phone you, what the fuck is going on? And I said, there's a story to it. You might refer to your board, but I'll tell you so and so and so. Actually, we couldn't get in. We could get some information, for instance, a workers' directory, which proved helpful to do a social engineering test. That hospital, they sort of were okay. The other hospital, Hospital A, they said, we're so happy to be part of this test. We really would like to see proven how secure our firewall is. And when we heard that the security depended on the firewall, we thought, oh. Within a couple of hours, we were in using SQL inject. They didn't know. We actually moved data around from the one place to sort of slogging it around there. And they never noticed. They really had no clue. And I'll show you what I got, amongst others. Huge files of all the patients. I could ask the hackers, give me a list of so-and-so. Everybody living in so-and-so. Everybody over 55, everybody under 44. Give me people sorted by disease. I had the codes for the disease. After all, we plucked them from the database. Okay. And the really bad thing is, it was 1.2 million people, 8% of the Dutch population. The really bad point is, I couldn't not only copy them, I could not only delete them, I could change them. And if I was less reliable than I am, I could do something very, very complicated. For instance, change the blood type of everybody whose third letter in their surname is a vowel. People would start dying and nobody would have any clue why they're... you get the drift. This is one of our hackers sitting in Hospital B. They got in. They had security codes and they got what they wanted. They left with 8,000 patient record files. The Secretary of Health, no, this mustn't happen and we're going to do everything in our power and blah-de-blah, you know the drill. They sent a letter to Parliament afterwards. The implementation of the national, the switchboard was sort of postponed. Security suddenly was mentioned 27 times. It was never mentioned before. There was a new set of safety rules which would become a touchstone. Then again, it was very much blah-de-blah. Also, as in explaining about the linings that you would have in the hospital corridors, that kind of safety prerequisites. And fortunately, they said that the law on medical secrecy might need to be reassessed because, of course, suddenly system admins, data entries, outsourced companies have access to patient records files. Well, they're not bound to medical secrecy. Mm-hmm. And everything went wrong on all the wrong levels. Hospital A, with the 1.2 million files, sent us the sysadmin, not the members of the board, while Hospital B actually sent the member of the board. And they started a full awareness training in the whole hospital. Actually, they even put themselves out. They said, we were Hospital B, Erasmus Hospital in the Netherlands. They retrained everybody. So what we have, huge problems, viruses, bugs, hacks. Improvement of healthcare is very dubious. Protection of highly sensitive data is severely lacking. And we still have many hospitals running Windows 97. What we should do, compartment compartmentalized data. That's very, very important. Better architecture. And privacy as the alpha and omega, not the sort of layer that you put over everything else. Trained personnel. We need data hygiene. There was Semmelweis, this guy who actually said, if you want to deliver a baby, you would start by washing your hands and instructing medical personnel how to be hygienic. Hygienic?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Data hygiene, that's what we need. And sloppiness should be dirty. A final thing, we have new problems. We're going to make much more medical appliances, pacemakers, insulin pumps. As it turns out, these can and are being hacked. At a presentation in 2008, people presented a pacemaker that they actually could switch off under the title, "Excuse me while I switch off your pacemaker." At the time, the cost of making the appliance, well, the cost of making the hack was $1,000. The company making the pacemakers knew about the problem and said, yeah, nobody's going to do it. 5 years later, the problem still existed, and by then it cost you only $10 to switch off somebody's pacemaker. Actually, there's quite some discussion that this might serve as a sort of new terrorist or even a new anti-insurgency measure. If you know that Bin Laden has an insulin pump, you just turn it off. that's the DEFCON thing, yeah. Beware and stay healthy.
One of the very best talks here was a fascinating talk, brilliant, by Nicky here. And I want to take issue with one point he made, which is certainly right as one general rule, except that I'm going to oppose the opposite general rule for the government to a large extent. Journalists believe, to a very large extent, I have found in the last 40 years, what the public believes, which is that the government can't keep secrets. How can they imagine, when a leak occurs, they say, how could they ever have thought that this could remain secret, this vast conspiracy? And how could they have thought that this sort of thing, so dehumanized, so cynical, so heartless, could remain secret, that people would keep that secret? Very rarely do journalists or people in the public react to a leak in a way that I would recommend very much, and that is to take it as a challenge to ask the question, why didn't we know this earlier? Why are we finding this out only now? How long has it been kept secret? And how many people actually did know and could have told us? Who lied to me, if I'm an investigative journalist, say, on this particular subject? Who was it who lied? How did they lie? Very few people are going to go back to that source, if it's a government source or she, and say, what made you think you had the right to, or what did you have in your mind when you told me this? Here's the evidence, and so forth. Because after all, you would lose them as a source from then on. And if they're still a government official, you don't want to enrage them that way, or to let the word get around that you have this kind of habit. But in very many cases, I want to say that, I'll put it this way. I identified very much with Chelsea Manning, person of, as it became clear, very different background, very different personality, different access, and so forth, much younger, for two reasons, really, in 2010, when the information from WikiLeaks was first coming out. First of all, it was a very large leak, and I'm going to talk just about a very specialized type of whistleblowing and leak now, not the ordinary kind, which is extremely important, just as important, but a particular kind, and that's of national security leaks that have to do with classified information in the first instance, and massive ones. For a long time, I'd waited and asked for massive leaks on the order of the Pentagon Papers, which was 7,000 pages top secret, on the grounds that it's very rare that one document, one page, it does happen occasionally, will really tell a story, will really break something open. It's too easy to say that's forged, it's not real, or if it's somehow authenticated, that policy was changed. That's a lower level staff piece of work here. Who knows who wrote that? It's rarely signed. as my friend Mort Halpern used to say, bureaucrats do not write what they sign, and they don't sign what they write. And so you have this piece of paper. What does it really mean? It was changed the next day. It does not represent the real policy, et cetera, et cetera. The Pentagon Papers had the advantage of being able to show many different responses, often with the same day, date, back and forth, and with the levels of authority being identified, policies actually being debated back and forth, and you can see the reasons bureaucratically, at least, not necessarily, not ever actually, the real reasons why the choice was made one way or the other, not ever even why the particular agency really is pushing this particular proposal, but at least you do see the arguments that are made and the considerations that are regarded inside as critical to the decision, and this is why we're making it. So you needed a lot. You didn't need 7,000 pages, perhaps, but 1,000 pages, 500 pages, and so forth, which is a very small part of what I had in one drawer of one of the many top secret safes in my office when I was in the Pentagon. But you needed that much. So for years I'd been saying that. I'd been waiting, not just for one other thing. The documents were very important, as opposed to paraphrase, a description. Even at the last moment, by the way, Abe Rosenthal of the New York Times and the publisher almost shied from doing the one condition I had made, which was recognized, as I later found, Neil Sheehan hadn't even communicated this, but I told him the one condition I made was a lot of material and documents being shown. At the last minute, they were so scared when they saw Joint Chiefs of Staff to the President, CIA estimates and so forth, top secret, President's eyes only and so forth. When Abe Rosenthal saw that in print, as it then was, on the linotype in those days, how can we be doing this and so forth? The Washington Post did not print any documents, nor almost did anybody else. And for years I'd been saying, documents make the difference. The other stuff can all be said, it's hearsay, who knows, it's secondhand and so forth. The document is usually lying too in various ways, for various purposes, even internally and top secret. But nevertheless, it's hard to argue, it's there, you said on this day, this person said this, and it didn't get wrongly communicated, and you can confront some with that, said, as like Clapper just now, saying to the Director of National Intelligence, when he says to the Intelligence Committee, in answer to the question, do you collect any kind of information at all with respect to millions or hundreds of millions of Americans? He said, no. Okay, went on from there. Now, later, when Snowden, thanks to Snowden, had come out, documentary evidence that indeed they were collecting hundreds of millions, as a matter of fact, under him, on Americans, he said that was the least untruthful answer I could have given. No one asked him, by the way. No reporter said, or anything, what would have been a more untruthful answer? Actually, it was, of course, the most untruthful. The truthful answer would have been yes. And another possible answer would have been a very plausible and reasonable. I can't discuss that in open session here. We have to go into a closed session for that. But that would have given a hint that there was some substance to the question being asked. Nothing, I think, but a lot number of documents would have conveyed the fact that he was flat lying. Not, by the way, to the committee, because the committee knew the answer to that question. Every member of it knew. But another thing that hasn't been brought out, by the way, I'm not sure they could get him on a perjury charge, though he was under oath, obviously. He was not trying to mislead the committee. They all knew the answer to that question, and he knew they knew. But it was the public that the Intelligence Committee was misleading the public along with Clapper. So forth. So we're all in this together. Now, so I wanted a large mass of material, but obviously when you put out a mass of material, like Chelsea Manning or Snowden, the chance of being found out is very much greater. In fact, the chance even of giving a single document, and if it's only a single leak, I've been saying for years to journalists, get the document. I know, for instance, a friend of mine who has the documents, I knew he had them, and he said, if you publish them, it would make such a difference. He said, Dan, I can't tell someone to break the law, and in particular to be identified. And as you were saying, you know, the problem with identifying. But when you change all those details, of course, with all respect, you aren't putting out the full story. You're protecting the source. The public is not getting the story that the source might have been willing, in some cases, you see, been willing actually to put out. But my friend said, they may be willing, but I'm not willing. I've never lost somebody to a prosecution. And even if they're willing to do it and take that risk, I'm not changing my career. I'm paraphrasing here a little, to put it out. Nevertheless, it does make an enormous difference to get it out, three things, in mass, with documents, and almost never now, but timely, at a time, in a connected way, telling the whole story, at a time when it can still make a difference. That's the very rare leak that you get in time. In fact, the one person I know that I've ever heard of, who did something in time, at high risk, easily identifiable, in time to actually make a difference, was Britain's Catherine Gunn, who, and with all the whistleblowers I've known, I haven't met another person. How many people here know the name Catherine Gunn? I won't tell the whole story now, but how many do not, just a matter of interest? Okay, look her up, Google, and then NSA will know what you're interested in. But Catherine Gunn with an A, by the way, K-A-A-T-H-A-R-I-N-E. And in GCHQ, by accident on her computer, she saw something she should not have, was not meant for her eyes, showing that the NSA was calling on GCHQ to tap the home and office phones of every member of the Security Council in order to manipulate them into a vote supporting the Iraq war. And this is a person who once saw that, saw they are using illegal means to get us into an illegal war. She downloaded it, and 24 hours later, she gave it to the Observer in time before the vote. And actually, again, I won't go into it, with hoping that it would affect the willingness of the Security Council to support that, which it did, and that if the Security Council did not produce a measure in support of the Iraq war, Britain would not, might not, or would not, and the U.S. might not attack, because Blair had actually said he would not go ahead without a second resolution. And actually, she did. She was critical in keeping, it's a longer story, keeping the U.N. Security Council from supporting it. Blair went ahead anyway. But, you know, at least it didn't have that cloak of legitimacy of the Security Council, but by acting fast. That's almost never done. Now, if she knew she would, actually, she didn't want other people to be suspected. At first, when asked about this, she said, no, of course I didn't do this. And then she thought about it for a day, and being as conscientious as she is, she decided, no, I don't want other people to be suspected of this, and she identified herself. And that's the story here of how that came out, actually, is very interesting, but I won't go into that. Okay, so she took the risk then of going to prison very much. At that time, Chelsea Manning could almost surely have gotten away with, then Bradley Manning, with not being identified, because what she was revealing was actually low-level stuff, in a throwaway line here. The secret stuff she put out, then Bradley Manning put out in the form of hundreds of thousands of cables, was at a level that I did not have time to read when I was in the Pentagon. I had to give a directive, don't send me stuff on Vietnam that is secret, which is what she put her on classified, only top secret, LIMDIS, XDIS, NODIS, stuff that she did not put out. She discriminated against it and so forth. It was amazing how much crime there was in that. I had to look back at it and realize I must have been missing more than I thought in the Pentagon. I didn't know they would put so much about torture and assassination at the only secret level. But so many people had access to that, hundreds of thousands had access to that, that they couldn't really have identified if she hadn't made the mistake of discussing, and this is the kind of thing, don't tell anyone, to Adrian Lamo. But that means that tens of thousands of people who saw this material as illegal as she did and surrounded could have done it. Okay, in Snowden's case, but when I read the statement that she made to Adrian Lamo in the chat log, I'm ready to go to prison for life or even be executed. I felt that's the way I felt 40 years ago. And I've been waiting 40 years to see somebody else say that, and I haven't seen that ever before, somebody say that. Now, just 3 years later, Snowden said almost the same thing. There are things worth dying for, he said to an interviewer. Just come from talking to Snowden. But again, in both cases, large numbers of material, almost Snowden's reason for identifying himself was the same as mine, and for that matter, Catherine Gunn's, not to have other people indicted and prosecuted, you know, and persecuted and even sent to prison for what I had done alone. So I always told the people I was working with, if there's going to be an arrest, if they choose to try, I was sure it would mean a life sentence for me, I will identify myself so that Les Gelb and Mort Halperin and Paul Warnke aren't prosecuted. And actually, the president did suspect them anyway, but they didn't prosecute them. So how often should there be mass disclosures of this level? Do we have enough without that? Does the intelligence process of the media versus their own government good enough? Does it work well enough? This balance we hear about, you know, and the back and forth, and they try to keep secrets and we try to get the secrets, and you know, that's how it works. How well does that work? Many journalists, I believe, and even more in the government, think, it works all right. We hear enough in time. They don't keep secrets that long and so forth. I want to say the opposite. Just as Snowden's message and the message you've heard today, which is encryption works, even against NSA. It occurred to me that what my message is to a large extent is, as an insider from the government for a dozen years, their secrecy system works. It is not true everything comes out in the New York Times or the Guardian or whatnot, even eventually. And indeed, what does come off is often so fragmented over such a long period of time, after the people have left the government, no accountability, and after the policies are either over or in such momentum that it's really too late to affect them. That's what the secrecy system is meant to do. Keep the secret long enough, that's all. And in a way that can't really be easily interpreted, when it comes, can't be related to other things. That's all it has to do. It doesn't have to be forever. But many secrets can be kept for very long times. And here's the key point I want to say. Known by thousands of people inside, and of whom thousands, a fraction of those thousands, know that it's either illegal, criminal, reckless, disastrous, hopeless. How many people knew exactly that of the Vietnam War in the course of the 30 years war, but the 10 years of the big war? Hundreds to thousands. How about the Iraq War, going up into the Iraq War? How many? There was no effective leak of what they were planning in 2001 and 2 and going on to 2003. They really got their way. No leak. Thousands of people inside knew not just that the policy was entirely different from what they were saying, which is normal, the norm. The policy to an insider is different from what the public believes and what the Congress believes. Normally, we have a secret foreign policy, a foreign policy that includes covert action, with which you say, well, okay, that's just a little embellishment on the policy. It actually may have the effect of being a provocation to the other side, of having blowback to which we're responding. As many people there are many, but only a tiny fraction of the public are aware, that our great enemy, ISIS, or ISIL, as they call it, has been produced in a dozen different ways by our own activities in the past. But hardly anybody recognizes that. So you don't understand the policy. But people inside, they may have a very distorted view of why it's happening, but what they know is it's different from what the public believes and is told. It's different from what Congress believes. And in many cases, they can see it's hopeless. The actions, by the way, right now, I won't go into it, but of US, my government now, bombing both sides in a civil war in Syria is as crazy and hopeless a policy, but murderous, as there could be. going into Afghanistan, going into Iraq, and so forth. These happened because none of the thousands of people who knew what was happening and knew that it was a disaster told any outsider. There was no Chelsea Manning at high level, you know, and no Snowden that got us into Iraq, got us in, and there are many people right now. So these people are to be sought for, and I want to, you should always be aware, the policy is different from what they're saying. They're misleading about it and lying, and consciously lying, much more than it's easy to imagine. I told my friend, close friend, best friend in journalism, Cy Hirsch, told him more than once, Cy, even you have no idea how much you are effectively lied to. You can't know. There's no way to know. So the policy is different. These people are to be sought, and in a timely way, a group called Exposed Facts, which seeks to be the American WikiLeaks, put up, just started by Norman Solomon and some others, put up posters around Washington. They paid for them, 13, and one is still near the Iraq embassy. One was half a block from the State Department. And it had actually a nice picture of me, full length, on it. And the words were as follows. Don't do what I did. Don't wait until the bombs are falling, until thousands more have died, until you tell the truth with documents to the press and Congress. Don't do what I did, do what I wish I had done in 1964 or 5 or 6 or 7. Go in a timely way and take whatever personal risk there may be. A war's worth of lives may be saved.